Hello, I'm Tony Guida. This is My New York. Suddenly, a 32-year-old movie is having a renaissance. Field of Dreams. An Iowa farmer plows under his corn to build a baseball field after hearing a spectral voice.
If you build it, he will come.
And shoeless Joe Jackson did come and bring his buddies. In August, that Iowa cornfield hosted its first major league game. The ratings were so strong, MLB will do it again next year. And coming soon to your TV, phone, or laptop, a Field of Dreams dramatic series. We wouldn't have any of this but for the inspired work of a kid from Long Beach, Long Island, Phil Robinson. He'll tell about writing and directing Field of Dreams next. Phil Robinson, old friend, good to see you. How are you?
I'm better for seeing you, Tony. How are you?
It's very sweet. I watched the film again last night. I teared up again at the end. Either I'm the biggest pushover in the world or this film is still magic after all these years. What do you think?
I think the former. No, it's, you know, it gets me every time too. And I every time I watch the film, and I don't watch it that often, but I say to myself, okay, I'm not going to tear up at the end. I know how it ends. I was there when we shot it. There's no surprise here, but it gets me every time. And I just think that's the magic of Bill Kinsella's story. The magic really comes from the book, Shoeless Joe by W.P. Kinsella. And one of the few things that I changed was I made the father showing up a surprise, and I put it at the end, because in the book, the farmer says to Shoeless Joe early on, "Hey, would you let my dad come and play with you guys?" And Shoeless Joe says, "Sure." And the father shows up about 2/3 of the way through the book, a surprise to neither Ray nor to the reader. And I just thought, wow, why give that away for free? Let's put that at the end and make it a surprise.
I understand when you first were told about the book, somebody recommended it to you and kind of summarized the plot, and you said, come on, get out of here. That's nuts.
That's right. She said, it's about a farmer. And I said, stop right there. And I'm a city boy. And she said, no, wait, he hears a voice. I said, oh, this is really not for me. And she says, then he has to go kidnap J.D. Salinger. And I said, okay, stop. There is a 0% chance I'm reading this stupid book. And she made me, she said, you have to go home and read this. She was a studio executive that I was working with. And I put it off. And finally, like 11 o'clock, I picked the damn thing up and I started to read. And I literally could not put it down. I sat up all night until I finished it.
A point you made there about in the book, he goes to kidnap J.D. Salinger. In the movie, you invented the James Earl Jones character, Terrence Mann.
I didn't want to do Salinger because I thought we're bringing Shoeless Joe back. Salinger is like one beat too many of weirdness. And also, I love J.D. Salinger. And he's only asked one thing of us all these years, which was to leave him alone. And I thought, we can do that. And I started to write sort of pale imitations of him. And then I was in New York. I saw Fences on Broadway. With James Earl Jones. And it was one of the greatest performances I've ever seen. He was such a man in that play. And I thought, boy, I'd like to see Ray have to kidnap someone like that.
I remember, I think a phone call must have been shortly after you read the book. And you called me and said, there's a book you have to read. And said, I'm going to make a movie out of this. And then I read the book and I said, I guess what everybody else in Hollywood said, you're nuts. You can't make a movie out of it. Guy hears voices. So that's what I know. That's why I'm not making the big bucks as a film director.
No, but you could have been a studio executive because that's what they all said. And I kept thinking, how dumb am I? What don't I know that they know? Because it just seemed so obvious to me when I read this book. It was visual. It was emotional. It was surprising. It was fantastic. I thought, why can't you make a movie out of this?
And you showed us. Were you a baseball fan growing up?
Huge, huge, huge Brooklyn Dodger fan as a kid. They were my heroes. And when I was five, my dad took us to Ebbets Field to see a Dodger game. And he had bought some tickets through his work. So he got us on the field before the game, and we got to have our pictures taken with Roy Campanella and the Knothole Gang guy, Happy Felton. But the picture of me and Campy, I've got my arm around Campy, he's got his arm around me. Just the proudest moment of my little life at that point.
Well, one of my great regrets, I never made it to Ebbets Field. You know, in talking about what you saw in the book, in adapting that book into that movie, there's a delicate balance. You're trying to make the unbelievable believable, lest it seem, and not be too heavy-handed about it, lest it seem laughable.
That was a real challenge. And for me, the solution was, I kept saying to myself, what would I do? Because I'm not a believer in voices and New Age stuff. What would I do if I heard a voice? Well, I would assume it was a sound truck on the highway or kids with a radio or something. And if I heard it again, I'd think, what the hell's going on?
Is there like a sound truck on the highway or something?
Nope. Hey, Karen, dinner's ready.
Kids with a radio?
Nope. Hey, are you really hearing voices?
Just one.
What did it say?
If you build it, he will come.
If you build what, who will come?
He didn't say.
I hate it when that happens.
Me too.
And I would keep questioning it. I'd make jokes about it until I finally had to, you know, suspend disbelief because I saw this vision.
In all those years, did you ever... Well, it's just I've heard that sometimes farmers out in the field, they hear things, you know, voices.
You hearing voices?
No. It's just that I heard that some farmers do, and I, of course, don't. So I was wondering if I was doing something wrong or something. Did you ever hear voices right there?
Who's hearing voices?
Ray is. Not in the fields.
No, I'm not.
The key in the screenplay was I had the character of Ray consistently saying, I know this is nuts, but he says it probably six different times. Am I crazy? Yes, I think you're crazy. So the audience doesn't say it. The characters are saying it. So the audience is saying, wait, these guys are out of their minds. And I think that allowed the audience to say, okay, they know it's nuts. So I'm going to go along on this ride with them. I'm going to see what happens.
Even the wife, Annie, she seems to be from the get-go ready to be supportive of this.
Right. And that's why I added what's not in the book, which is the sort of the 60s background. They had gone to Berkeley and they were really products of the 60s. Because I thought that little extra bit of their backstory would help us understand the idea of following dreams, breaking convention, not following the rules. And I think that part of the key of casting Amy Madigan was I wanted somebody who you could believe that about, that 60s background, but also who was strong enough that if she said no, he wouldn't be able to build the field.
The Costner character and the voiceover at the beginning of the movie, I majored in the 60s. But now they're older and they're kind of approaching or in middle age, and maybe this is their last chance to grab those dreams they were thinking about back then.
Absolutely right. And to me, that's one of the things the movie is about, is what do you do with those dreams and the ideals that you held as a young person, that helped define you as a young person? What do you do with those things when you are older, you have responsibilities, you have a family to support? How do you stay true to that younger self? And I find those issues interesting, and I thought the book in a way spoke to that.
Have we mentioned you hated the title?
Oh, we haven't mentioned it, but I did. The book was called Shoeless Joe. We shot the film under the title Shoeless Joe. All of our crew swag says Shoeless Joe, our hats and our coats. And I was in the editing room and Tom Pollock, who was chairman of Universal, called me up and said, listen, we can't call the film Shoeless Joe. And it came out of the blue. I said, why not? He said, we tested it and audiences think it's about a hobo or they think that Kevin plays a homeless guy, and would come up with a better title. And I said, no, Shoeless Joe is the title. It's a great title for this. They finally, the studio came up with a booklet this thick of names. My favorite one was Dad's Second Chance. I thought, that's let's really? Give away the surprise ending in the title. And finally he said, we're going to call it Field of Dreams. And I thought it sounded like a room deodorizer or a feminine hygiene product or something. And now Field of Dreams with lemon. I just thought, that's a soft, awful title. And he said, it's done. And I had to call Bill Kinsella, give him the bad news.
The author of the book.
The author of the book. And I said, look, first of all, it's testing very well, but the studio won't let us call it Shoeless Joe. And he said, oh, I don't care about that. He says, that wasn't my title. That was the publisher's title. I said, what was your title? He said, Dreamfield. And I thought, okay, I guess I lost that argument.
Ray Kinsella, the Costner character, is estranged, or well, estranged, I guess, from his father. One of the reasons is his father's hero, baseball hero, was Shoeless Joe Jackson.
Yeah, there's an interesting moment when James Earl Jones says, you know, why did you say this terrible thing to your father? And he said, I was 17. And I thought it didn't really need much more explanation than that. That was really at the heart of so many father-son issues that our generation had, and probably previous generations and successive ones. But he focused on this Shoeless Joe aspect. I couldn't respect a man whose hero was a criminal. I think that was a superficial reason for him. I think the real reason was just natural teenage rebellion. But he couldn't get out of it. He said this horrible thing, he went away, and then his father died before he had a chance to take it back. And I think that guilt is what really drives him, what opens him up to this experience, and what drives him to see it through. You know, building the field is really for Shoeless Joe, and it's the grand gesture. It's like putting flowers on a grave. It's like, I can't apologize to my dad, so the least I can do is build this field. I don't really think Shoeless Joe is going to come back, but I'll build the field because it's the grand gesture.
Are you actually thinking of doing this?
No. I mean, I can't think of one good reason why I should, but... I'm 36 years old. I have a wife, a child, and a mortgage, and I'm scared to death I'm turning into my father.
What's your father got to do with all of this?
I never forgave him for getting old.
I read where you had a dream, a fever dream, a reverie, something when you were on location in Iowa, and you had this epiphany. I now know what the book means. tell that story.
Well, the movie means a lot of different things. I woke up one morning having sort of in that half dream state with this revelation, and I immediately called Larry Gordon, who was the producer back in LA. And I said, Larry, I figured out what the movie's about. And he said, what? I said, it's about art. He said, what? I said, yeah, an artist is someone who hears a voice or he sees a vision, and he takes the materials around him and he creates something new and sort of surprising. And some people can see it and some people can't see it, but it allows him to resolve something inside him. I went through this whole thing. I said, it's about art. And Larry said, don't you ever tell anybody that.
Gonna kill this thing before.
Exactly. He said, do not tell the studio that, and never say that publicly.
One of the rules of Hollywood. Art does not belong here. Art does not live here.
Well, also, look, at the time, baseball was not considered a commercial subject for a film. A farm wasn't. A family story with no, you know, car chases or gun battles wasn't. We were really kind of breaking all the rules.
Let's get to Iowa. You pick a farm and just right outside the place called Dyersville, and the problems, there were some serious problems with this shoot, starting with a huge drought,
right,
on Iowa.
Worst drought since the Dust Bowl.
Really?
It was a 50-year drought. And we had a we had a schedule based on the growth of corn. We shot all of the scenes that didn't involve corn, so we would allow time for the corn to grow. And while we're off doing these other scenes, the farm advisor would say to me, you know, we're having a drought. And I would say, yeah, drought, you know, got to go back to the set, see you later. And one day I drove by the set and I saw that there was no corn. And I said to the guy, what's with the corn? He said, I'll tell you, we're having a drought. I said, yeah, but I've got grass at home bigger than this corn. And I said, 4th of July, corn up to here. I'm Kevin, right? Because that was the schedule. And he said, no, 4th of July, corn up to his ankles. And we realized we were in big trouble. We wound up damming up the creek that ran through the farm. We trucked in water and we built this irrigation system. Massive growth, instant growth of corn. And I said to the farm advisor, whose name was Eldon Trum, I said, Eldon, why don't you guys all do this? And he said, you just spent $20,000 on water. That's more than many of these farmers make in a year. And it was heartbreaking driving to the set every day. It was a half hour drive from Dubuque, and you'd pass field after field after field of stunted corn. It was like nothing. And we had this glorious crop, which of course then we plowed under to build the baseball field. It was a really sad experience to see what the American farmer goes through. They're just completely at the mercy of nature, and they'll go years without making a profit sometimes.
Somewhere I heard that you, as a hedge here, because of the problem with the corn, that you lined up fake corn?
The production designer found, and I'm not exaggerating, all the fake corn in the world. He found it in like Korea and Japan, all through Asia, they make this fake corn. And he put a reserve on all of it. And we were prepared to ship over all this stuff and one by one, plant them in the field. It would have been a spectacular thing to watch.
Make a documentary out of that.
We could have made a better movie about that.
No, I doubt that, but an interesting movie nonetheless. So if you got a drought and you got corn problem, what about the grass?
Well, the grass, you know, we had the ball field was laid out with sod, and we had a guy from LA who does sod for Dodger Stadium and the Rose Bowl and whatnot. His nickname was the Marquis de Sod. And they laid out all the sod. And I said to him, so, you know, Monday morning, I'm going to be on the field. You know, he says, no, you got to give it a couple of weeks before you can walk on it. I said, no, in 2 days, we're going to have guys and equipment and trucks and lights and things. He said, it's all going to die. I said, well, what do we do? He said, you do what we do at Dodger Stadium after a rock concert. We get out there and we paint the grass. So we had a
paint the grass.
We had a guy with a tank on his back and a nozzle. And every morning he was out there painting the grass. It's not a field of dreams. It's a field of dead grass.
Have you written this story? You need to, you should have written a memoir about making this movie.
I might. It was an extraordinary experience.
Yes, I know. And it was I remember visiting you in Los Angeles shortly after it came out. Mm-hmm. And I expected to see a guy bubbling over with, you know, joy and excitement about, you know, the hottest things on, you know, in Hollywood at this point. I mean, the movie had come out. It wasn't expected to do well. It did very well. You wrote it, you directed it. And you were burned out. You were, tell me what, and you took a year off.
Yeah, I took a year off because I was just I was physically exhausted. I was emotionally exhausted. And I wasn't sure I wanted to go through it again. It was so mentally taxing. And I was just drowning in doubt the whole time. I mean, every day on the shoot, we'd go to dailies at the end of the day. And I would look at the footage and I think, oh, it's another day where I didn't get it. I blew it. And I'd go home and I had horrible dreams. One night I dreamt these people are coming at me with knives. And they're making the psycho knife motion. And I'm backing up and they're coming forward. And I say, who are you? And in unison, they say, we love the book. I had that dream.
Oh.
And when we finished, I thought, I don't know if I want to do this. I don't know if I want to direct again. And if I don't direct, I'm not sure I want to write again, because I don't want someone else to direct what I write. So what am I going to do? I don't have any skills to do anything else in my life. So I thought, I'm going to take a year and just take stock and figure it out. And I'm not going to think about movies. I'm not going to have meetings. And during that year, I went to the theater a lot. I saw the movie a bunch with audiences who allow you to see it through their eyes. One of the great ironies is, as a filmmaker, you never see your film the way an audience sees it, because you know too much. You never go in as a blank slate and let the film take you over. All you see is your mistakes and the things you wish you'd done differently. And I so envied, I wish I could have erased my memory for a day, and gone and seen the film without knowing anything about it. But going to the theater, you see it through the audience's eyes. You can feel what they're feeling. And I thought, okay, this is worth it. This is good. But I'm not going to do it again unless the project is incredibly meaningful to me on some level. It's just not worth it to do it just as a job. I'd rather do something else. So that year, I just kind of hung out. I traveled a little bit, and I thought about my life and kind of just recharged the batteries.
I'm glad you recharged the batteries.
One other thing about that year off, I remember somebody saying to me, how can you take a year off after a hit? And I said, no. How could you take a year off after a flop? If the film had flopped, I would have felt compelled to get back on the horse immediately and to try to prove something. And I did it again after Sneakers. I took a year off after Sneakers. So apparently it wasn't so much philosophical, it was just that I'm lazy.
I got to ask you one more, another scene, the final scene. Kevin Costner, the farmer, and his dad are now playing catch at night on the field, just the two of them. And we see the camera kind of rise up, and there are lights, there are cars coming. Looks to me like hundreds of cars are coming.
That idea came to me during a lunch with the Iowa Film Commission, where they were saying, look, we'll do anything to get you to shoot the film in Iowa. We'll give you free office space, and we'll give you a warehouse where you can set all your equipment and things. What else do you need? And as they're saying, what else do you need? I thought, it'd be kind of cool at the end of the movie when they're throwing catch, playing catch, we pull up in a helicopter and we see cars as far as you can see. And these people from the Iowa Film Commission said, we'll get them for you, whatever you need. So while we were shooting, one day the still photographer and I went up in a helicopter at lunch and took a big wide picture of the whole area around the farm. And she blew it up into a huge thing like this. And I took a magic marker and I drew the route where the cars should go. And then we had a production assistant drive that route to get the distance, divide by the average length of a car, and we figured out we needed 2,500 cars.
What?
2,500 cars. And by God, they got us 2,500 local people and their cars. We did a whole promotional thing. We had a local radio station broadcasting from the farmhouse to give them instructions. And when it was time to do the shot, I was up in the helicopter, and I was communicating via walkie-talkie to the cinematographer who was in the farmhouse next to the disc jockey, so he could relay instructions to the cars. And the first take, we did a little bit too early. We knew it was too early for the light, but we wanted to get one under our belt, and it looked really good. And the second take, it was just perfect. It was beautiful. And then we had time for one more take. We did a third take, and I noticed in the second take that the cars had kind of gotten closer together after the first take, and it didn't look like they were moving much. The front row of cars looked, but that whole long line looked like they were stopped. It looked like we had strung lights out on the road. So during the second take, I said, have them alternate their high and low beams and on my cue. And so on a certain point, they start doing that, and it gives the illusion of twinkling lights and movement. And that was the third take. We land. Two nights later, we're watching dailies. The first take is very pretty, but it's the light's too bright. The second take with the perfect light, as the camera rises, the camera assistant, instead of opening up the aperture, shut the aperture down, and the screen went black. The take with the perfect light, the screen went black.
No. So you have
3 minutes.
One more take.
One more, but we didn't know, did he make the same mistake on the third take?
Ah, of course, of course.
Because if he had, we're really screwed. The longest 3 minutes of our lives, and then the third take came up, and it was beautiful.
Making magic in Hollywood. This is how it happens. I have to, Phil, I want to tell our audience that Phil is coming back next week to discuss a whole other facet of his career, extraordinary journalism, a television journalism. But before we leave the subject of Field of Dreams, I want to tell you or quote from Karen James's review of the film in the New York Times. This is what she said about Field of Dreams. It's so smartly written, so beautifully filmed, so perfectly acted. It does the almost impossible trick of turning sentimentality into true emotion. I don't think you can say it better than that, can you?
That's beautiful. That's lovely.
Well, I'm glad you're coming back next week, Phil. And I said the reason I asked you to do that is to let the audience see some of your remarkable journalism for television. Remarkable enough that it made a big impression on the former host of Nightline. Listen to this.
Phil Alden Robinson has turned out to be a wonderful and totally unexpected asset to this program.
You will see why, folks, next week. See you then.